thank you for grace and mercy. We thank you for allowing us to be in your house this morning, Lord God, as we give back, Lord, a portion of what you've so richly blessed us with, God. It's all yours. As we give back to you this morning, Lord God, may you bless it, Lord, as you receive it and further your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. this morning to church, and the ambulance had to come get him and take him to the hospital. He was having some problems in his chest, and so if you would remember him in your prayers, we really appreciate it. It is my privilege and pleasure this morning to have our Gideons with us. I met Brother Tom Besh several years ago, actually when his daughter was in Rocky Mountain Academy playing basketball. And, he and his wife, and she graduated from there, and she's just graduated from NC State. And she is actually, she hooked me up here recently. I went to Liberty for a class, as you know, for an intensive for a week in October, I believe it was, in October, November. And I told Seth this year, I said, Bud, I said, if you were about two games into the season of football, he was like, Dad, I'm not playing football anymore. And I said, Bud, I said, you're not going to quit something you started. I said, my son's not going to be a quitter. And I said, you're not going to start this and then stop it. I said, I'll tell you what. I said, if you'll give it your all and you'll give it everything you got and you'll work hard at it, I said, then you'll see what happens. And I said, if you'll do that, he loves basketball. And I said, I don't understand how you can love basketball being 4'1" and round like your dad. I don't understand. Short and round people just like basketball. I don't understand how you like basketball. I can understand if you're Ron or something, but anyway, okay, that's your favorite game, then okay. He said, I said, I'll tell you what, I said, if you'll do this, man, you'll give it your all and you'll try your hardest, I'll take you to the NBA game. And he was like, okay, all right. And so halfway through the season, he hit our starting center, got hurt, and so Seth had to step in. He ended up playing the rest of the season, the last four games, started, played the whole game, and I thought after the first game it was going to kill him. But he came off the field. I was like, yeah, see there, I told you, if you keep working in practice, you won't be inside of breath. And then the next game we played, I had a kid that was about twice as tall as Seth, and he was blitzing, and he absolutely de-cleated Seth. If you don't know what that means, he hit him so hard and took his cleats and feet out from under him. And I looked over, and I was like, he's done. Here come out the game. He's finished. He got up and chased it. I was like, man, so it taught him something. But I forgot all about what I promised him and told him. And I'm up at Liberty, and he texts me and says, Dad, football season's over. Don't forget, you got to take it to the NBA game. And I was like, okay. So I started looking around at tickets, and they were at the nosebleed section, and the very top of the section was $85 a piece. And I was like, man, it's right here at Christmas time. This is ridiculous. It's crazy. And I was like, man, I was like, Christopher, I made a promise to him. I got to do it. I can't get fired for my son. And I was like, okay. I was like, Lord, I don't know how I'm going to do it. I'm sitting there laying there, and I was like, okay, bud. And he was so sacrificial in it. He said to me, Dad, I know his favorite team is Golden State, other than the Hornets. But his favorite team is Golden State because he likes Stephen Curry, who is a Christian, who inside of every shoe that he, you know, a lot of the athletes in the NBA have their own shoes now. And inside his shoe, it says, I can do all things on every tongue that's made a shoe that he puts out through Under Armour. And so that's his favorite player. So I said, why do you want to go see him play the Lakers, though? Sean play the Lakers. He said, because I know it's a Wednesday night, Dad, and I know we have church. I know you can't get away. And I had someone say to me, hey, I feel ill for you on Wednesday night. Go take your son. You got 3 weeks of vacation anyway. Don't worry about it. And I was like, man, that's awesome. Thank you. So I didn't say a word to him. And I thought, well, let me see what I can do. And then I remember Tom's daughter actually is on the dance team for the Charlotte Hornets. And I said, Instagram is a great thing. And I sent her a direct message on Instagram. And I said, Victoria, I don't know if you remember who I am. I told her who I was. And I said, do you know if they have any discount tickets anywhere at all? I said, I know one time before, I actually got free tickets. Andy Jackson gave me one time for pastors in this area. The pastor from Pastor Gilliard from Word Tabernacle wasn't going and gave me his tickets. And so she said, I get two free tickets to every home game. And she said, so don't broadcast it, everybody, but I'm thankful for it. But she said, I get two tickets, and she's complimentary tickets, and I'll be glad to give them to you. And here's what she got. Here's where she got. She said, for a brother in Christ, I would be glad to. I said, well, what would they cost? She said, nothing. She said, thank you for serving the Lord. And I was like, whoa, man. Okay. Yeah, they're awesome. And so I was able to say, hey, you know, And I didn't say a word to Seth. I picked him up, and his daughter really had a hand in that. And I picked him up at school at 11 o'clock, didn't say a word to him about it. We got about halfway to Greensboro. He thought we went to a doctor's appointment in Nashville. And I reached behind the seat, and I handed him a Charlotte Hornets jersey, or Charlotte Hornets t-shirt, and then I reached behind the seat and handed him a Stephen Curry Golden State shirt. So Seth's house said, listen, it's not right. He said, why'd you get me two of them, Dad? I said, if somebody gives you free tickets to get in somewhere, you don't go in there wearing the other team's jersey or other team's colors, okay? So you have to put your Stephen Curry shirt on and then put your Charlotte Hornets one on over. So that's what we did, walked in, and he met the girls on the dance team, took some pictures with him, and then she came up and talked to him, and she's very, very, very talented in music. And then Travis was telling me this morning, he was like, man, her brother is too, and things too. And so Tom came and one night here to the church on Wednesday night and spoke to me. He was like, hey, man, I'm in the Gideons. I'd like to come speak. And I was like, hey, that works for me, man. And I was like, I'll get with you. And I got lost in the time and things too. But one thing that stuck with me was his beard. And I told him in the first service this morning, I said, you know, I've had people come up to me. They're like, hey, Pastor, why is your beard like darker and everything, you know? So I'll go ahead and tell you, so you don't have to gossip and talk about it. I'll go ahead and tell you. I know there's been some talking. It's been talking. My wife busted on me this week, and they laughed. So I'll give you a laugh at my expense this morning because I don't mind. Just for me, it works, okay? $6.92 at Walmart. Get you some and just brush it right in and everything. And after it darkens up and everything, just go wash it out. It works really good. And mine would be fully gray if I didn't. And so my little girl says, Daddy, I like it like that because you don't look as old. And so Sam told me the other day, he said, some of the kids at school were saying, when you came to pick us up the other day, or when you dropped us off, some of the kids were saying that your beard's darker than your hair. So I had to go to a lighter color, you know, so I just started doing that. But that was where it came from. When I saw his beard, I was like, man, that dude's got a cool beard. And I've never been able to grow a beard, never. And it would grow in patches. And so I grew it out, and Christian said, that thing looks a little shaggy. You need to start shaving and trim it down a little bit. Let it be trimmed a little bit. So I had to let it grow on out a little bit, and it's a couple times, and trim it. So now I got it kind of where his is. And just for me, it works, trust me. So, and this week, have you ever seen the games? I know most of us have anyway, some of the little kids maybe not have. The game where it's a man's face, he's bald, and you can take the maggot and you drag the little stuff over to him and put it on his face. Okay, I walked out this week, and when I walked out, I had the just for me and on, you had to let it dry. And I walked out, and Crystal starts busting out laughing. And I said, what? She said, Sam. He comes out steps, he's like, dude, look at you. And Crystal said, you know what he looks like? He looks like that man in that game that you drag the stuff over there to him. So it was all funny games till she pulled it up on her phone, okay, and started showing everybody the pictures of the man with it and all. So we had a good laugh at that expense this week, but that's where I got it from. So I told him, I said, Lord, I know it's not right to covet his beard, but that dude's got a pretty beard. And I want to try to get that. I couldn't get it, so I had to grow it in several times. And so I haven't shaved it off yet just because I kind of got attached to it. And Sam told me the other day, he said, don't never shave it off, man, because you won't even look the same anymore if you did. So it's coming. That day will come. But I'm thankful for it, and I'm thankful for him. I'm thankful for his family, and thankful for his daughter reaching out. She'll never know what that meant to me and my son to have that time. When we went on the way back home, he said, Dad, thanks. That's one of the best things I believe we've ever done in our entire life. And just an awesome time to have together with that. And so I'm thankful for him, and it's my privilege and honor to turn over our pulpit this morning to Brother Tom Besh. I want to make a welcome.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Like most of you, I'm a Southerner, born and raised in the South Bronx, Fort Apache Bronx, New York, New York. To New Yorkers, they call me a Southerner. Wow. I moved to North Carolina almost 30 years ago. And I married a free will Baptist preacher's daughter. At that time, I joined my father-in-law's church. I'm 100% Italian. I went to Catholic school in the late 1950s and 60s, where I tell my kids we're nuns. We had 50 to 60 kids in the class. The nuns ruled the class with a 3-foot pointer stick and a big bar of brown soap. Nobody messed with the nuns. I was taught the fire and brimstone kind of religion.
That's good.
Either you're with God or against God. There's no straddling the fence. And as verse in the Bible, Jesus says, he who is not with me is against me. I went to church 6 days a week during the school year, except on Saturday when my Jewish friends went to the synagogue. When I studied to become an altar boy, it was in Latin. Back then, the Catholic Church celebrated the Mass in Latin, except the priest's sermon was in English or the local language. I had more than a dozen prayer books, novena books, missal books that had many, many passages of the Bible. But I never had a Bible. The Bible was on the shelf with the Encyclopedia Britannica. Here it was right up there. Never had a Bible. All that education, never had a Bible. And back then, when I graduated from school, I had money to buy a tract and travel load of Bibles. I didn't buy not one. It's very interesting. When I married my wife, my mother and father-in-law gave me my first Bible with my name on it. Never had one. And I realized, I didn't understand. I didn't have all that religious education. I didn't have a Bible. You know, the Catholic Church more or less believes in the same Bible as the Protestant churches, just like the Orthodox churches. But yet, they relied on the prayer books rather than the Bible. Very interesting. And so I was telling the congregation this morning, I never knew what the Gideons were. Some years ago, I was looking at some real estate. An elderly man was showing me his real estate. We climbed the mountain, we walked in the fields. I thought the guy was going to die, he was out of breath. Then he smiled and pulled out this out of his pocket. And he looked at me and said, "Do you know who the Gideons are?" And I said, "Some Jewish organization?" "No." I said, "Well, there's a guy in the Bible named Gideon." "I have a Jewish friend named Gideon." "No," he says. I said, "Who are the Gideons?" When I first became a Gideon, I went to my very Catholic Italian mother and I said, "Ma, I became a Gideon." And her first reaction was, "Oh my God, you're a Jehovah's Witness." I said, "Ma, the Gideons are not Jehovah's Witnesses." Then my mother said to me, "Well, what denomination are these Gideons?" I says, "Ma, the Gideons are not a denomination. The Gideons are an interdenominational Christian businessman organization. We do not preach or hold services. We are simply an extended missionary arm of yours and other Christian churches. But without the support of the local churches, the Gideon ministry would have business." Years ago, I took my kids to McDonald's, and I looked up, and on the sign it says, "Billions served." Well, the Gideons have also served billions, but not hamburgers. Since 1899, the Gideons International have served billions of people the Holy Word of God through the distribution and placement of the Bible in more than 90 languages, in more than 200 countries around the world. Wow! That's a lot of places to go. A question that always comes up is, what translation of the Bible do you use? Well, our standard translation is the King James Version. Unless when we go into a church and the pastor says it's okay to use the NIV or New King James Version. But why we use the King James Version only as the standard? There's a word today called politically correct. Well, the Gideons have been politically correct since the 1890s. Why? Because, especially back then, there are many Protestant churches in the United States that if you quote a verse other than the King James Version of the Bible, there's big complaints. But most importantly, when we go to places like Central and South America, Western Europe, parts of Asia, which is predominantly Catholic, then we go to places like Eastern Europe, the Middle East, we have many different Orthodox denominations, such as the Coptics in Egypt, the Maronites in Lebanon, the Ethiopian church, the Armenian church, the Ukrainian Orthodox, the Greek Orthodox, the Russian Orthodox, all of the Orthodox churches and the Catholic Church accept the King James Version of the Bible. With the little caveat is in the Old Testament, the Catholic Church and the Orthodox Church has a few more books in the Old Testament, such as the Maccabees, there's a book of Tobit, which has the angel Raphael. And the reason that's so important, the translation of the Bible, that's accepted, because if we go into a foreign country, the local priests or pastors are condemning us, we can't get in. God forbid if you're a Jehovah's Witness, you won't leave Russia. Russian Orthodox Church is very, very tough. It's interesting. The Russian was very anti-religion when Lenin took over. All of a sudden, they're very religious. Even Putin claims to be Russian Orthodox. It makes, in a lot of ways, if you go to Russia, they're more religious than the United States. And, you know, for years, especially when I was in Catholic school, I never knew there were more than one translation of the Bible. And believe it or not, the majority of Christians in the world don't know there's more than one translation of the Bible. And the biggest offender is the Russian Orthodox Church heretics is the Jehovah's Witnesses, because they print their own Bible and they edit it for their own doctrine. Most people don't realize that. So again, the King James Version of the Bible, even though it's the toughest read, it's a good opening line and we're well accepted. And all the Orthodox churches, the Gideon, let me stop right there. The Gideon ministry is a Protestant ministry. There's no Catholics or Orthodox. But the Orthodox churches, the Catholic Church, really applaud the Gideons. And they welcome us in, which is very important. So if we're not allowed in, we're never going to go in. And you know, in all the years the Gideons have been around, we go where you cannot go. Especially with terrorism today and high security. You can't walk. You can be the most devout Christian in the world. Try getting on a military base. You can't. We have access. The hotels, especially the high-end hotels and motels. You just can't walk in. I'm a Christian. Can't have you arrested. We have unprecedented access, which is a blessing from God. And that's the reason for that is supporting local churches. It's amazing. And you know, one of the things that I also learned after I became a Gideon was the fact that, and I mentioned before when I graduated from school, when I had the money to buy, when I was single, I had the money to buy a whole tract of treble load of Bibles, I didn't buy just one. It's an interesting phenomenon. I saw it as a Gideon. You see, it's the will of God that not the angels in heaven, but man himself shall deliver God's word to his fellow man. And that's what we do as Gideons. We deliver God's word one Bible at a time. And it's interesting. And it made my eyes open up because it took someone, despite what my mother and father wanted, give me a Bible. No one ever gave me a Bible. We don't have a Bible. It's interesting. And by growing up with all my religious education, not having a Bible, that makes me very excited what I do here. It's very exciting. Many people's lives have been changed by that Bible in a hotel motel drawer. Or a Bible they received in a handout, or in the military, and so on. It's the Gideon testimonies are countless. And, you know, in Matthew 28:19 and Mark 16:15, Jesus gave us the Great Commission, commanding all of us to spread the gospel to the whole of creation. Well, together, we can obey this will of God to evangelize all the nations in part through our Gideon ministry. Because us Gideons go for you where you otherwise may not be able to go. By God's grace, last year we placed and distributed over 80 million Bibles and New Testaments to students in schools and colleges, to prisoners, and to police, fire, and medical personnel, as well as to our men and women in our armed forces. We placed Bibles in designated traffic lanes of life, such as hotels, motels, hospitals, and nursing homes. It says in Hebrews 4:12 that the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. You see, since 1899, more people have been brought to God and back to God through the placement of the Gideon Hotel Motel Bible than the entire population of communist China that has over 1 billion people. Wow! What a statistic that is. You see, the promise of Isaiah 55:11 is fulfilled, as God's word does not return void. As men, women, boys, and girls come to Christ through reading the scripture placed by your Gideon ministry. The Gideons have published many books containing thousands of salvation testimonies, telling how your Gideon ministry's placement and distribution of the Bible has changed people's lives. The Gideon salvation testimonies are many, but my time here on the pulpit is short. But please let me share with you some interesting facts. When Saddam Hussein was sentenced to death, he cursed the judge and waved in his hand a copy of the Quran, the Muslim equivalent of the Bible. That Quran, as well as all the Qurans given to Saddam Hussein's men and the insurgents in the prison camps in Iraq, and all the Qurans given to the Al-Qaeda and Taliban in the prison camps in Afghanistan, and all the Qurans given to Osama bin Laden's men in the prison camp in Cuba are all receivers of U.S. taxpayer-paid copies of the Quran. I repeat that. U.S. taxpayer copies of the Quran. The U.S. government gives no Bibles to our service men and women. And I'll repeat that. The U.S. government gives no Bibles to our service men and women. The principal supplier of Bibles to our military since before World War II are you, through your Gideon ministry. And I'll tell you a quick story about the congregation this morning. On September 6, 1941, a day before the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor, 5,000 Bibles from the Gideons arrived in the Philippines, the General MacArthur's office. December 7th, the day after the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor. Shortly after that, the Japanese invaded the Philippines. Despite the heroic battle of the Filipino Army and the U.S. Army, we lost. MacArthur had to go escape to Australia. Many, many thousands of Americans were held as POWs. The Japanese had something called, one of the many atrocious war crimes they committed was the Bataan Death March. The Japanese gave very little food to our American POWs, very little medicine, very little clothing. You got your clothing when someone died. When General MacArthur, several years later, his famous saying, "I shall return," liberated the Philippines, and they got into the freed the American POWs. One of the few things those POWs had were pages, excerpts of 5,000 Bibles the Gideons sent on December 6, 1941. What a story it is. Our government, at all levels, city, county, state, and federal, spend billions of tax dollars every year trying to rehabilitate all the people in the different prison systems. The number one rehabilitator in all the prison systems is the Bible. Prison officials will tell you that. Our government gives no Bibles to the men and women in prison. I'll repeat that. Our government gives no Bibles to the men and women in prison. But they can give Korans to the all the people in the different prison systems. Unbelievable. The principal supplier of Bibles to all of our prison systems are you through your Gideon ministry. There are many more surprising facts, but I will bring my Gideon report to a conclusion. Our number one request to you today is that you use the greatest power God has put into our hands, prayer. Please pray for a steady flow of funds to purchase Bibles and open doors in this community and in states and countries that need them the most. If God has placed it on your heart, I ask you to consider it a financial gift, because every Bible we distribute and every life-changing salvation testimony is a direct result of the generosity of somebody just like you. You see, we have no Jerry Lewis-type telethon or televangelist on TV asking for money to purchase Bibles. The Gideons are a local church ministry. Volunteers like myself and Ernest are it. There are many places that we go that we give out one Bible, and as many as six go without, because we are limited by the donations we receive to purchase Bibles. We urgently need more donations to purchase Bibles, so together we can fulfill Jesus' command of the Great Commission. You see, this is a big fact. 100% of every dollar you distribute will be used to purchase and distribute Bibles. Because us Gideons pay all of our own expenses, and our dues pay for the Gideon office staff in Tennessee. Very few ministries can make that statement. If you came unprepared today to make a gift, there's a take-home envelope in the Gideon Church bulletin. Your 100% tax-deductible check to the church, and the church would then make a master donation to the Gideons. One thing else I'd like to say before I conclude. Your church has been very, 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 very supportive of the Gideons. And words can't describe how appreciative we are, all the people you've helped throughout the world. When we started here in the United States, and we spread out throughout the whole world. And thank you, thank you, thank you. Pastor Todd and all of you here today, I thank you very, very much for your opportunity to share with you the good works of the Gideon ministry. And it's a privilege to participate in your worship service today. May God bless you all. Thank you.
Thankful for Brother Tom. Thankful for the Gideon ministry. Amen. I want to share with you this morning from John chapter 17, beginning verse 14. In the book of John, it says in verse 14, I have given them the word, given them your word, and the world hates them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one. They do not belong to this world any more than I do, Make them holy by your truth. What is the truth? The word of God. Amen? Amen. Teach them your word, which is truth. Just as you sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world. And I give myself as a holy sacrifice for them, so they can be made holy by your truth. You know, we can't go to all the places of the world. We can't go into all the countries of the world. We don't speak all the languages of the world. You know what? We may not reach everyone in this entire community, but I believe God's called us to. I believe God's called us to reach everybody. Brother Tom shared with you this morning the Great Commission in Matthew chapter 8, 28 has been told us to go into all nations, to go everywhere, preaching and teaching. People have said to me before, Peg, you may have heard it too, I've been told in that the government, oh, they'll take Bibles out eventually. You won't be able to worship here, and you won't be able to, well, the Word of God says, hide the Word of God in your heart. Okay, they can't take my Bible from me. They might take the written part of it, but they can't take what lives inside of me. The Word of God should live inside of every one of us. But how can they live inside of them if they've never seen it before? How can they live inside of them if they've never known it before? How can a person be saved unless they know how to be saved, unless they have the Scripture and the truth of the Word of God in their life? And John says that the Word of God is power to take the Word of God and go into all the world, sending them into the world, and that's what God's done with us. So I challenge you this morning. We're going to go into our invitation time, and if God's convicted your heart today, if you got something to pray over, I'll be glad to pray with you at the altar about it. Maybe you're here today and you've never given your life to God and you never surrendered like Christ did. Today's your day. Maybe you're here today and you're seeking out something that you just really, really, really has burdened you hard today. I'll be glad to pray with you. And after we finish our time of invitation, after we finish our time of ministry time here at the altar this morning, we're going to take a love offering up, and we'll take that up, and it'll be separate from the offering this morning. But if you're not prepared, as Brother Tom said, put that in a check. You should have the bulletins that you came in from the Gideons. You can put that in there and send it to them. If you're making a check out, make it to the church, put it in the bottom of the memo section, Gideon International. And Ms. Winifred has one check just to write to the whole, from as a whole. So you can just write to the church and put down there. We support them, love to support them. I can tell you, I had one, a Gideon Bible in the Marine Corps. And I'm thankful, too, for that they do. I know for me in the Marine Corps, I'm thankful that they use the King James as the primary one, a translation. But in all honesty, I like what he said, shared too, that they do have other translations. They do the NIV, and they do the ESV, and they do the New King James. When I was in boot camp in the Marine Corps, I'd always known it was nothing but King James. My mom raised me in church my whole life. She sent me my first NIV when I was in boot camp, and I started to read it, and I was like, oh, I actually understand what I'm reading now. I've had several talks with youth pastors and things too, and even young adults, and they didn't understand what they read, and there's no reason for them to read it, and they're not going to read it if they don't understand what they're reading. And so I challenge you to give to that, and to give to this great, great, great organization. One thing I'm really thankful for too is that what he said is that the reason why they choose businessmen and the model is set up for that is because that way 100% can go towards purchasing the Scripture. As I shared with you before, this year we've done Operation Christmas Child, and like I said in the first row, I'm not bashing Franklin Graham's ministry by any means at all whatsoever, but we decided to go in a different direction this year and to help out local families in and out of our church for Christmas time, and so that we could see that, and it would all go towards those families instead of somebody's pocket. Because I looked at the salary, you can go look it up, I think it was $875,000 a year. It's a salary that comes from that, between Samaritan's Purse and between Billy Graham Evangelistic Ministries, so that Franklin oversees. I'm not bashing Franklin by any means. I'm just saying, you know, what he said to share was powerful. The reason I said that is because I've received texts and phone calls from people that you as a church have helped out over Christmas, telling me all about what they did with the kids and the things and the kids that we helped out, the clothes they got for them and all these things. And last year, one of the same families we helped out this year, we had that last year, they gave receipts back. I didn't share it with the church because we don't tell who it is. But they sent receipts back. I just want you to know, as a church, of every dime that was spent for those children. Never in 7 years I've been here ever had anybody do that. And so I thought it was pretty awesome to see. So I just want you to know that's where it's going. And so every bit of money that you give to the Gideons will go towards purchasing Bibles. All right. Go ahead.
That's just everybody that you just enlightened me on. Pastor was talking about the government suppressing the Bible, destroying the Bibles. Well, when Lenin took over Russia, then Stalin followed suit. They burnt the churches, killed the priests and people. It was totally atheistic. Once the communist state collapsed, the church was under threat all the time. The Russian Orthodox Church surged up. More than 25,000 churches were built and rebuilt. And they couldn't be any worse. I mean, Stalin, in some respects, was worse than Hitler. He killed like 25,000 of his own people. Stalin. He was a brute. He had to be our ally at the end of the war, but he was partners with Hitler. Hitler stabbed him in the back. But, Russia was very, very atheistic. So soon as the communist nation collapsed, then Russian Orthodox Church surged. In a decade, 25,000 plus churches were built and rebuilt. It's amazing. So as much as Lenin and Stalin tried to destroy religion, it's amazing.
They'll never be able to destroy God's word either, amen?
Amen.
Not if we had it in our heart like God tells us to, too. Thank you so much, Brother Ernest, Brother Tom. Thank you for what you do this morning as you stand to your feet as we sing our invitation hymn, hymn number 305. The hymnals are there in front of you. I have decided to follow Jesus. Jesus went all over spreading the word, sharing the word, teaching the word, preaching the word, and that's what he's called us to do, amen?
Thank you for the meetings, Lord, and just pray.